but it is a fragrance of the Rig Veda. We can study the whole Rig Veda, that is not possible within a short time, but within this 1 hour, I will try to cover the Rig Veda. But before that, as you usually do, let us chant this mantra. Ya itam devam, ekavritam veda, sa sarvasmai vipashyati, yaccha pranani, yachana, tamidam nigatam saha, sa esha eka, eka brid eka eva, sarve asmin deva, eka brito bhavanti. To him who knows this God as one, neither second nor third nor fourth, he oversees all that breathes and what breathes not. To him goes the supreme power. He is the one alone. In him all deities become one only. So this is the Hinduism. So many varieties of gods and goddesses, but still it is all one. And that is exactly the goal we have to reach. And what is this one? The Atma. What is that one? That the Jnana, the knowledge. And there in the second sloka in the small paper, have you got? Or I will just chant and you can repeat after me. Naham manushyo, na cha deva yakshaha, na brahmana, kshatriya, vaishya shudraha, na brahmachari, na grihi vanastava, bhikshurna cha aham, nija bodha sarupaha, nija bodha sarupaha. Who am I? I am that Supreme Consciousness which is pervading everything. That is the Hinduism. And Swami Vivekananda said, religion is realization. What is to realize? This knowledge. What knowledge? Oneness. Of all these things. Now, how it developed, we will try to find it out in the Rig Veda. In our last discussion on November 22nd, we have discussed about the antiquity of the Vedas. And we could understand that it's so difficult to find out the antiquity because it's very, very ancient. We have also noticed that of all the four Vedic Samhitas, the Rig is the oldest and has a special place in the Vedic literature. We will discuss the Vedic literature in my next class or maybe afterwards. It's a collection of shuktas or the hymns revealed to various rishis or sages at different periods of time. It is said that Rig Veda had 21 divisions, shakhas, and only 5 are available now. And these 5, as we named, very difficult to remember again, Shakala, Bhaskala, Ashwalayan, Shankhyayan, Mandukya. As because of the Mandukya Upanishad, we are familiar with the name Mandukya, but these are the 5. Rig Veda is having 10,552 mantras. They call it mantras. These slokas are called mantras. With a view to facilitating memorization, the whole Samhita has been divided into 10 mandalas, 10 divisions, and the mandala divided into Anubhakya, Anubhakya into Shukta, and Shuktas into Mantra. So this was the system to memorize. According to this system, the total number of Anubhakyas are 85, Shuktas are 1028, Mantras are 10,552. Rigveda topics may be divided into three groups. First is regarding the deities, Agni, Indra, Varuna, Atri, Pusha, etc. And then comes the secular subject. Most of the time we think the Veda means all spiritual. We will see, we will read that how the Rig Veda is talking about so many very, very our mundane life, how to develop that, etc. And then the philosophical, of course. Then the origin of the universe, the real nature of human, these are the three. Now, if we see this way, in the first mantra, Agnim itte purohitam yajnasya devam ritvijam hotaram ratna dharamam. We can understand those who have studied the Bhagavad Gita, this Sanskrit is little difficult. This is the most ancient Sanskrit. And sometimes it is not, and today's grammatically correct, sometimes. Why? Because in those days, the grammar was not there. Afterwards, the grammar was particularly Panini. He wrote the grammar and things were analyzed and properly shaped. Now, this is the mantra that he is telling. In the beginning, I glorify Agni. In the beginning, they say, talk about the Agni. Why Agni? Because they discovered fire. They discovered Agni. The day the human being discovered fire, from that day onwards, things started changing in the human life. All the civilization based on that particular discovery, that is fire. And usually, wherever I go, whenever I am talking with the students, I always ask this question. So what is education? Because you are all there in the education. What is education? The mostly there are, of course, hundreds and one are definitions are there by so many different educationists about the education. To me, education is the combination of five actions. What are those five actions? First is observation, discrimination, utilization, preservation, transmission. These are the five things totally education that completes. First, observing the ancient people, primitive people, they are observing the two, the huge branches of a tree, it is rubbing together creating fire, or the two stones rubbing together creating fire. And that way they were observing minutely. And then second step after observation, it's not only seeing. We sometimes see and then we forget. But it is not registered properly. So it is that observation means very minutely seeing a thing. And then comes discrimination. They started thinking whether this fire is going to help us in any way. So the discrimination, then they came to know, yes, the fire will be very useful. Then utilization, they started utilizing the fire. And after that, they didn't forget how they created fire. So that knowledge they preserved. And then when the next generation came, they transmitted that knowledge to them. So observation, discrimination, utilization, preservation, transmission, these five actions together called education. And we can see that all those processes were over when they were writing Rig Veda. So the Agni was already there. So the Agni, so they are mentioning Agni, they are thinking in this way as a god. But how the conception of God came, there are many, many theories are there. And in the theory they say our ancestors, people, they were living with us, they were with us, and suddenly they passed away, they went somewhere else, and we are wondering where they have gone. From there, the conception of God has come. If you go to the primitive people, even today, particularly, I have seen with my own eyes the places like Nagaland, Mizoram, all these, and the northeastern area, they always keep their ancestors in the caves, the body of the ancestors that wrapped and kept, and then particular day they go, they bring it out, they worship, they feed, and then put it back again. All the Hindus, they in particular day they go to the Ganga or Jamuna or Godavari, and they offer oblations, prayer to the ancestors. Ancestors are always there with us. We will see in the Rig Veda also, they are praying to the ancestors. Now, this is the one thing. And secondly, they say, after seeing the nature, that also, that they thought that this is the God. From the nature, they were thinking. So here, some people, they are thinking that the great people, the ancestors of the present Indians, were living in the midst of the grandeur and the sublimity of nature. Towering snow peaks, vast green meadows, gigantic rivers, boundless seas, splendorous of the splendor encircling the land of the three sides. The ineffable splendor of the season all produced an abiding effect upon them. Nurtured amidst such environments, the ancient Indians developed poetic and spiritual temperament and a deep introspective mind detached from the mundane world. The natural phenomena was acknowledged with awe and reverence, and they started praying. Agnim idde purohitam. The purohita, that you are there before us for our benefit, hita, for our benefit. Now we call the priest as purohita, and they are very close to the God, to the image, and they are giving, offering all our things we bring, and the purohita, they are offering it. So this purohita, the word has come in the first 111 of the Vedic stotra, the purohita. The very first mantra of the Rig Veda, it speaks about the purohita. Who is this purohita? Agni. And this Agni, what he is doing? He is the messenger of my oblation to God. He is not God. Agni is not the God. He is the messenger. Now, they have brought this, the parij over here, and they are thinking that we will offer it to God. So that is in the same system, we are offering, we are not gods, but they are giving it to us. Why? To give it to God. With what? Prayer. Prayer for what? We will see one after another. I will go a little faster instead of quoting the Sanskrit, which is very difficult even to remember. So they go, may Agni, the divine priest, who is glorified by both the past and the present sages. The always, this has been used, we see, by humbleness. They always recognize the previous sages, previous good people. They have recognized Agni and increase and strengthen our bond with the Devas. May Agni, the divine priest, increase and strengthen our bond with the Devas. Who is the Agni? Purohita. So the conception of the Purohita is coming. Why? He is supposed to help us to develop the bond, the love, devotion with God. So this is the conception of the Agni. Again say, Agnina Raim Ashnavat Posham Eva Dive Dive Yashasya Birasyattam. Praying to God through Agni, the angel priest, may we, the worshippers, obtain valiant offspring and daily increasing prosperity and glory. What for we are praying? Not for any religious or spiritual thing. we are praying. So see the how the prayers are developing. In the beginning, the prayer is only for our protection, only for our prosperity, and let that Agni, the Purohita, carry this, our oblation, our prayer, our devotion to God, so that the God, with the blessings of God, we obtain valiant offsprings and daily increasing prosperity and glory. So some people, they criticize the Indian philosophy and Indian religion. They make people sad. They always talk about death, always talk about misery, and always talk about that transcendent world. That's why they are not successful in this world. Wrong. When we look at the Hindus in present day, we are thinking in that way. But previously they were very, very prosperous. And that is why the whole world, they went over there. The Hindus, the Indians never came out. The world went over there, the whole of Europe. They were sailing uncharted sea. For what? To have a tourism over there, just to see the India? No. They went for the prosperity. India was prosperous. How? Through prayer, through faith. And we will see, O Lord, we recognize you amidst the enlightened persons. But how we come to know about God? See how they are giving that's why in the Rig Veda, the lot of explanations, we recognize you amidst the enlightened persons. How we know, O God? Because we have not seen you. But when we see the enlightened persons, we can recognize you. And they are closest to you. We implore you not to pass us by. Please do not forget us. Please do not forget us. So that is that we have come to know, not directly, but through some enlightened people. Sri Ramakrishna's words, Sadhu Sangha. And present day, they always say Satsang. So through that only we come to know. We ask you to come to us and give us enlightenment. Please notice the two prayers. To whom? To Agni. And first prayer for the prosperity, for the offsprings, and for the glory. And second prayer for the enlightenment. So this way, both things are going. That's called both the development of the spirituality and the science and the mundane world, the materialistic world, both were flourished in India in an excellent way. Prayer seeking good life, and they say, Lord, help us attain our objectives. Help us acquire a sharp mind. Grant us food, make us prosperous. So what is the prayer? The sharp mind. Why? Unless and until the mind is sharp, we won't be able to understand things. Grant us food and also make us prosperous. And some time came when the people started criticizing the mundane world and we became very weak. Bhagavan Sri Ramakrishna came once again. He brought back this truth of Vedanta, this truth of the Veda, and he said, Khali pete dharma ayana. The empty stomach, you cannot practice religion. And again it says, seeking the protection, God be unto us easy of access, so that we can go to you, we can pray to you, we can talk to you, and that is the easiest way. Somewhere the God is sitting and all the time I have to go through somebody. No, easy to access. First Purohita. And now they are thinking, why not directly go to approach to God? So how the thoughts are changing. We recognize God through the great lives of the enlightened people. Then we go to God, pray to God through someone, that is Agni. And then now we are going to God directly. So the change of thoughts are coming. Be unto us easy of access, as is a father to his son. So closeness of the God, previously they were afraid of God. Now the closeness of God, as is a father to his son, in the teachings of Sri Ramakrishna, is one time he is telling the Sikh community, they came in Dakshinesha and they were praying, Sri Ramakrishna was attending the prayer, and in all the prayer, you were so gracious, please do this to them. Then Sri Ramakrishna, why you are talking so much of the thankfulness to God? He is our father. He has created us. It is his responsibility to look after us. So look at it. That is the great faith. God, you have created me. Now you are responsible to protect me, to give me food, to give me every success. Like a son goes to his father and claim. And then we find, and they say, talk about now a personal God, Vishnu. And he said, idam Vishnur bi chakrame tridha tridade padam. This is the story afterwards developed as the Bhamana avatara. The Vishnu, in his H capital, stride the Lord Vishnu, took three steps, and the whole universe was controlled in the dust of his feet. Hail to the Lord. How the conception is developing. And the same story afterwards, they were telling, the Vishnu came, a person, a king, he was generous, he used to give a lot of gift to people, helping people, but he was very, very pride. He used to say, I am giving. So the Vishnu came to make him humble, to bless him in a different way as a Bhamana avatara, a very short figure, at least very small figure, Vishnu. And then after he told, I want only three steps. The three steps? You take many other steps, no problem. The three steps will be all right. You say yes to me. When the moment he said yes, he became the huge Vishnu. And then in one step, he covered the whole heaven. In second step, earth and others. And third step, where I will keep. He was a devotee, he understood, he said, on my head. So that is Gaya, the Gaya Asura. And it says, O loving God, this whole world with its wealth belongs to you. You are the one who has given us life. You give us the love and the protection of a father. You are our friend. You make us strong and brave. You defend the doers of the virtuous deeds. You make it possible for men to acquire hundreds and thousands of material possessions. Good men flock to you. The prayers are changing, thoughts are changing. Everything that we see is nothing but you. Then it says, O God Almighty, I am steeped into the darkness of ignorance. I need to be moved into the light of your wisdom. And afterwards it said, now it comes, may Deva Indra, the glorious, augment our welfare. May Deva Pushan, the all-knowing, augment our welfare. May Deva Surya, the protector from misfortune, augment our welfare. May Deva Brihaspati, the granter of wisdom, augment our welfare. So different names of the gods are coming, and then it says only one prayer, the very famous prayer, Bhadram Karne Vishnu Mama Devaha. Most of our people, the Hindus, they will be chanting. And nowadays the Sanskrit is getting the promotion, and many people, and if you learn, I mean, if you listen to the discourses and the news that they are reading in Sanskrit, is so simple. And this Bhadram Karnevi Srinuvama Devaha, may we listen with our ears to what is good. May we see with our eyes what is good. May we with firm limbs enjoy the term of life granted to us, singing your praises. So it goes to directly only two prayers. First, they were protectors, make us this thing, give us that thing. Now they are telling, only give two boons. What? we can hear good words and we can see good things. We can hear good words through our ears and see good things through our eyes. And then we will develop. So this is, pray do not make us so infirm. Look at it. In America, so without prayer, they are practicing it. Putraso yatra pitaro bhavanti mano madhya rishitat ayur gantah. Here the parents are praying to God, pray do not make us so infirm in our last years that we may need the parental care of our children. So individuality, I am not going to depend on our children. They always say, why this? Because the moment you are thinking my children will help me, that means you are not a real father or mother. You have something behind your love, and love is without any condition. The moment you are thinking that when my child, I am protecting, I am giving education, and when he grows up, he will take care of me, is a business. You are investing, and then you want to get the return. So, to be free from that, they are praying, do not make us in that way so infirm in our last days, last years, that we may need the parental care of our children. This they are praying, the parents are praying, but it is also the children's duty to take care of the parents. Here we find, madhubata ritayate madhuksharanti sindabaha madhirna santoshadhihi. We always chant, these are called shanti mantraha. Is the your worshippers who live righteously, for us, your worshippers who live righteously, O Lord, let the breeze be fragrant, and all this, let waters in the rivers be sweet. Because we like to live. So these are the prayers. And then we find another prayer. Shamno mitra, sham varunaha, shamno bhavattarayama, shamno indra brihaspati, shamno vishnu rurukramaha. These are very famous slokas, and it goes down with the prayer shanti mantra. May mitra, our friend and protector, be propitious to us. And similar way, Varuna, Aryaman, Indra, Brihaspati, Vishnu. Who was the first god? Agni. But do you really call Agni the god? No, messenger of God. We are giving the oblation to Agni and praying him carry it to God. We respect you, but please help us. You are not God. You are very close to God. You can carry the food to God. So that's why in his Christian conception is the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost is not God, but is close affinity to, close to God. So we are praying to that Holy Ghost to go over there. And before the Holy Ghost, who comes? Jesus. Here the Purohita. And then Purohita transformed to Agni. And Agni carries the message and the prayer and the oblation to God. And then the conception of God coming down, because that conception of God somewhere we cannot conceive, we cannot understand. So we are bringing them down to the personal level, and it is Mitra, it is Varuna, it is Aryaman, Indra, Brihaspati, Vishnu. So this way protect us, God, from the sin, pleased with our dedicated virtue become our friend. Our virtue, let it that be our friend. I am little hurrying because time is short. Lord, you see it all because you are present everywhere. The conception of God, the all-pervading. Tvam hi vishyato mukha. What is that vishyato mukha? Everywhere, all present. Who is telling it? Not the present day philosophers, Rig Veda. The conception of God in all-pervading God is so ancient in the Indian philosophy. And when we fight that this is our God and that is their God, I really feel, are they really Hindu? Because they have not gone through the pages of our Veda on which our whole Hinduism, edifice of Hinduism is standing. And here we say, tam hi vishyato mukha vishyata paribhurasi apa na shocha agam. And here it says, Lord, you see it all because you are present everywhere. You notice our sins. We may be repentant of our sins. Sins means the present day translator, he is using the word sin, but actually it is failure. There is no conception of sin, but as because now in the present day we can understand the word sin, so he is translating, but it is failure. So we could not concentrate on you, we could not realize you, we could not fathom you. It is all a failure, it is not sin. And sometimes we said something which is not true, the false. Sometimes we were angry, failure. It's not sins. You are disdainful to the lazy. See, this is the psychology of the Hindu. They never supported the lazy people. You are disdainful of the rich person who does not help the poor and the needy. See how the society now taking shape. And then at the time of, we can understand from here, at the time of Rig Veda, we call it Satya Yuga, there were sins, there were failures, and there were rich people and poor people. So everything that we see today, it was there in the Satya Yuga. But today it is much more, that time it was little less, that's all. So there is no society where all these things were not present. And you are disdainful to the rich person who does not help the poor and the needy. They both quickly perish. And we find over here, let the words of the truth be spoken. Let the deeds of wisdom be performed. Now the morality is coming. All after the prayer, then there is a system should be developed, that is truthfulness and wisdom. So they are praying to God. Wonderful rewards await for those who gives pious gifts. The sun shines in heaven for such persons. They enjoy a long happy life in this world and indeed attain immortality. Now this is the way now they are teaching. So if you are not doing it, following the norms, not helping others, then the God will be angry with you. But if you are helping, so again and again and again, from the time of Rig Veda, the charity has been praised. Why? The moment you can give it love. Charity, sometimes some people are coming and on the gunpoint you are giving some money, that is not charity. But when you are giving that money with love, that is charity. In the Christianity, in the Islam, in Buddhism, in Hinduism, they are talking about why? In the Rig Veda, in the beginning itself, they are talking about the one chapter 1, 125th sloka. This is in the beginning. They are talking about the charity. Why? Because I have earned this. And I am now sharing it with some people who are not close to me, no blood relation. Some people whom I don't know, but I feel pity for them. That is the reason. When I feel love, I feel pity, a compassion, and there I go out with my own property, own money, helping them. So that gives us, supports us, and we become the religious. So the wonderful rewards, awards, they say, and it says, may God-loving people always be helped by other people. So if you are a God-loving, then other people will help. That we always feel in our life. And then there's a wonderful poem that Rabindranath wrote, and someone was telling that I was trying to help this society, but now my days have come, I have to leave, I am going to die. Now you people, I have called you, invited you, you are assembled over here, I request, who is going to take my responsibility? No one was agreeing, no, I cannot do that. Matir Pradeep chilo, sheko hilo shami, amar jetuku shaddho koribota ami. Then there was an earthen lamp. The sun was asking, now I am sitting, I am going to die. Who is going to give the light to this world? It needs light. Everybody was quiet. Then none was ready. Then this Pradeep, the earthen, the small one, lamp, it says, whatever my possibility, I will try to give it, share it with everyone. These are very beautiful words in Bengali. Matir Pradeep chilo, he was there, the ardent light. She kohilo, it said, Swami, my master, the son, shaddho koribotami, whatever my, it's my possible for me, I will do. And that is the main thing. When we are helping others, how we are helping? If we have the money, we share it with others as a charity. If we have any other things, we share that as a charity. If nothing is there, pray. At least we can pray. So that is there, they say always. Yona Agni, and this a wicked person who meant malignas others by his speech, thinks of others, refrains from charity, indulge in deceit and trickery, hurts himself by his own such deeds. From here, Swami Vivekananda said, why this morality? What is the basis of morality? Because of the society? Because of the foolish? Because some people will criticize? No. You are going to hurt yourself. Karma theory is coming. In the Rig Veda itself, the indication of the karma theory. If you are doing something good, you are going to hurt your good, you are going to be benefited. You are doing something bad, you are going to hurt yourself. And again about the charity, it says, and good actions also, may I travel the Lord's favorite path, which is the delight of the good God-seeking men, and which leads me to wide-stepping Vishnu, the friend of the pious, and whose abode is all bliss. So the Vaishnava is also as ancient as the Vedanta. So the Vaishnava cult is coming, and it says, may I travel the Lord's favorite path, which is the delight of the God-seeking. What is that? Good actions, charity. Then how suddenly they are asking here in this chapter, they are asking katara purava katara parayo katha jane kabaya ko viveda vishwam tvam na vibhrito yaddha nam bi virtete ahani chakri eva. Rigveda 1.185. It says, how did the earth and the sky come into being? All these days they were telling God has done. And suddenly philosophy is coming. And there they are asking, how did the earth and the sky come into being? In what order were the various components of the universe was created? No one knows. Not even the most learned amongst us. All we know is that the day and night keep revolving as though mounted on a wheel. As though mounted on a wheel is, but we do not know why. The asking is coming. And here we find the name Aditi. Aditi is the mother of all gods and goddesses. Now why suddenly the mother? Because we see in the creation there is a father and there is a mother. So Aditi is the mother. Shakti cult begins. The Shakti, there, it is creating. So naturally, the Shakti, the Aditi, I pray to you for prosperity. For a life without injury and pain, I pray for abundance of food. Protect us from all kinds of dangers and evil forces. Sometime we do not understand to whom to go. Some people, they say that you should not pray to God about the mundane things. Sri Ramakrishna is telling, but for whom? For the sannyasins only. But for the mother, for the father, for the householder, they need to go to God for all these protections. And here they say, Agni nayas supatharai asman, Vishwani deva bayunani vidwan, Yujashmayasya juhuranameno, Bhuishtam te nama uktim videma. Lord, we bring to you our adoration. Lead us through the righteous path to richness. Lord, you know every sacred duty. Remove the thoughts from our mind that make us stray and wander. This is a very important prayer. Then Sri Ramakrishna is telling, one cannot even pray to God if he is not blessed by God. It is only by the blessings of God one can have that idea and the mental strength for this. So this is the main thing. And it says, again, the first line it comes, Ei oru, arektum barota shumai kuru. So gananam tva ganapati, this is the first name is coming, Ganapati. Marathis will be very happy to see that Ganapati Bappa Moryo said Ganapati, the first word came in the Rig Veda, and you can remember the chapter 2, 23rd sloka. Here it comes to that prayer of devotion, Gananam Tva Ganapatim Hava Mahi. We are offering to you, we hail among us, your subjects, you are our master, hail to you. Ganapati. Gana means all that we see. And Pati is the master. You are our master. That's why Ganapati. And why is the elephant head? That is again, this is the philosophy. It's not talking anything about the elephant head. But to give an idea to the ordinary people that it is all pervading, it is huge, they thought about the elephant, because elephant was the biggest, huge elephant in animal. So people can think about the hugeness. The vast is the ocean and the sky, but you cannot depict it in a human form. So human form, all the good qualities are there, only head is elephant. Just to give the idea, it is vast, it is huge, it is big. So that is Ganapati. From here only begin with. Now here in this again, the prayer seeking wisdom, that's the famous prayer, and each and every Brahmana at the time of their sacred trade of ceremony, they say, Om Bhur Bhubashva Tat Sabitur Varenyam Bharga Devascha Dhimai Dhiyo Yo Na Prachodayat. Now it is in the cassette. Previously they used to say the Brahmanas, they used to say you should not, non-Brahmin should not utter, but now it is in the cassette. And everywhere they are going on, and some people even in their telephone, the tune, Bhubhubhasha. So, what to do? And nothing wrong in it. Why? Because it is here, they say, the Gayatri Mantra, the earth, the sky and the heaven praise him. Let us meditate on the glory of the Divine Lord. He is the one who sustains us. We pray to him that he may direct our understanding by instilling wisdom in us. And next, I don't know whether I'll be able to complete. So in the next, very, very, very peculiar, those who have not gone through the Veda, so I have separated all this. And here we find in the second it comes, very, very mundane. What is that? Housewarming prayer. That means they were having the good houses that time. They were not under the only little huts, good houses. And they say, O Lord of the dwelling, recognize us. Let this house bring us comfort. Protect us from ill health. Be pleased to fulfill our dreams. Bestow your blessings upon us and on our animals. Because animals were at that time the wealth. So they are praying to God, please bless us and our animals too. And this is our house we are going to live. So please protect us there. Be our protector and preserver. Augment our wealth. May we, through your friendship, become exempt from decay. Be caring to us like a father is to his children. So they are talking about constantly about this prayer. Lord, I am not in control of myself. And that is the reason I have been a sinner. Alcohol, anger, gambling and ignorance have led me into the wrong path. Even in dreams, am I not free of sin? Who is talking? Is a present day person? Yesterday only one gentleman came, very well established, highly educated, and he was constantly, he never visited any Vedanta society. He saw our website and then from there he came and then straight to came here, and with great hesitation he was telling, can I kneel down before you? Can you please put your both hands on my head? Because my mind is not under my control. Here, yesterday, and now I am reading from the Rig Veda. And in the Rig Veda, in the 7th chapter, it says that my mind is not under my control, please protect me. So, human being, the mind, it was all same. So, when we talk about the Veda, we always think each and every one was truthful, everyone was happy, not like that. We were there that time too. So obviously, like us, the people, they were also there. So we should not think that we are in the Kali Yuga, some people they go on chant Kali Yuga, we were suffering, nothing like that. Every Yuga was like this. And here it says, is a wonderful prayer, it says, may the prayerful couples be blessed with the sons and daughters. Immediately after the marriage, they are praying for this newly wed couple. Putrinata kumarina vishwam ayura vyashunutaha ubha hiranna peshaya. Now here say, may the prayerful couples, the couples should be good and prayerful, be blessed with sons and daughters. May such couples enjoy their full span of life in prosperity and decked with gold. So that the one day has been declared like American way, Black Friday. They also, what is that? They go and purchase the gold? Dhantaras. Now, so they were not knowing the word Dhantaras, otherwise they were used. So it should be decked with the gold. So the same thing. Now, here also, always at the time of marriage, as maximum gold possible, the father of that girl, the giving. And here they say, those who are kindled in the fire of hard work, gain maturity and receive your blessings. O omniscient, omnipotent Lord, those immature people who live in sloth do not receive your blessings. So see, this is called Hinduism. It is based on the Veda. So always encouraging people to be hard working. And we have forgotten it. We are going on granting only from the government side, we will give this, we will give that, going on. For whom? Why? Who is going to give you? Here, some people they are bringing food in the Sundays. And I told Na, those who are interested, they must pay at least $5. Then many of our devotees, why they would like this? Because some people are giving it as a free. So then I argued, no, at least the $100 we should earn. So Monday, the lady who will come, she can clean and then can get that her salary, that money from that money. And moreover, why one person should take, that is coming to ashrama, that's true. But it's not to you. Why should I not give a supportive money so that the strength should come? No, I have paid and I am taking food. It's not your food. And then someday that man will say, hey, I gave you food. Have you eaten? Have you taken that food? Was taste was all right? What type of thing is this? So that's why the self-respect should be always, every moment. And it says that one, troubleless, trouble-free be the path. And may Deva Pushan himself led you. To whom? They are telling newly married couple. Particularly to the bride. It says, may Pushan Deva himself led you by hand from here. From the father's house is going to the in-law's house. May the Ashwins carry you in their own chariot. O bride, go to your new home to become the ruler of the house. Meri Kanya Raj Karegi. In Hindi they say, after the marriage, Raj Karegi. The Raj Karegi is not nowadays words. Even in the Rig Veda, only those parents don't know. Otherwise, they could quote from the Rig Veda. I searched the Rig Veda and found out this lokas only to. Actually, everything was as we are doing. So, go to your new home to become the ruler of the house with authority in your voice. Can you imagine? That's why I didn't marry. Anyway. O bride, may happiness attain you in your new home. May love increase as you bear children. Unite your person with that of your husband and continue to rule over the household all your life. Let this bride be attended with good fortune, requesting the God, before you depart for your home. And now it is talking about the guest. When the guests come, they should pray. And depart of your home. Come one and all to meet her and wish her happiness. And now the marriage it goes. I take thy hand in mine for good fortune. The man is telling to the woman. Let thou mayest live to old age with me, thy husband, Deva, Bhaga, Aryama, and the boundless Savita have given thee to me for you to become the ruler of my house. And that's why nowadays they don't say housewife, they say homemaker. So it's a good word, that's correct. So these are the prayers from the Rig Veda. And again, O bride, in the presence of the sacred fire, have you been given to your husband? May you live long, may your life be filled with glory, may your husband see 100 summers. So the long life of the husband. And it says, may you make a stable family, never to separate. Enjoy the full span of life, happy, sporting with the children and grandchildren. So this separation, may your father-in-law treat you as a queen. May your mother-in-law treat you as a queen. May the sisters and brothers of your husband, best sisters and brothers of your husband treat you as a queen. Why this? Because the lady who is coming, from her only a family is coming. It's not only just attachment and love and emotion, no. At the back of it, total sociology is standing. Because that lady, she is going to become the mother. And if she is not educated, if she is not having the command, she cannot develop that family properly. The husbands are going out, all the male folks, they are going out, and then everything this lady is doing, including the education of the children. So if that is wrong, then everything is wrong. One or two mothers may be beating their forehead because their children, and now they have become a very infamous names in the whole world, the terrorists. And they were also the children of some mothers. And how they are thinking, oh, why my son could not become a good man? Rise up, O woman, talking about the widow. Rise up, O woman, to the world of the living. Your husband is dead. Take the hand of a new man and start your life again. Who said in our country, even today, the widows are tortured? And in the 18th century, 19th century, a very famous person in Bengal, he tried to do reform and tried to bring the widow marriage, Bidya Sagar. And why? It was already there in our Rig Veda, at the ancient Veda. We don't read, we don't understand. We only think the Rig Veda is talking about the spirituality. Of course, we are just talking about the spirituality that will come in that in our next discourse. And here it says, rise up, O man, to the world of the living. Why? Because she was thinking that who is going to support her? So, to the world of the living, your husband is dead, take the hand of a new man, start your own life. And then finally, women feel good hearing the flatterings, admiration from men. How the psychology they are. But warning, those who are gracious and beautiful get to choose the man of their choice. It's not that the father and someone of the family giving heart to somebody else. No, it is our own choice. And then it can come to the second caution to the women. Some women are trapped into accepting a man by his sweet talk. I'm not talking about the modern days. I'm reading from the most ancient scripture. Some women are trapped into accepting a man by his sweet talk, but those who are smart and careful in selecting their husband are blessed. So one should be the lady, she giving the freedom to choose her husband, but at the same time caution is giving. So the most of the good people, they are very sober, gentle, can't talk. And that's why the women can't understand them. But most of the people who are very good, nice talk and all this behavior, smart, and if you marry, then you have to suffer. So many of the times we have seen, so that is the reason in the Rig Veda, I actually chose these because to understand this is our Rig Veda. They were so cautious for everything. And how was the society? They were very nice people, religious people. And then they say over here, my wife is good natured. She never quarreled with me. She was loving to me and kind to my friends. I have driven her away from me because of my addiction to gambling. It is not the Mahabharata, it is the Rig Veda. Why I am repeating again and again? It's so close proximity. My wife has rejected me, and my mother-in-law dislikes me. No one is offering to help me. A compulsive gambler who has lost everything, I am unwanted as an old horse. So gambling was rampant. Every time you open the newspaper of India, you'll find the ladies are going and breaking that all this country liquor making shops. And because of these. And I have an experience. I was in the Purulia, and just before our school, it's a big school, so the guardians coming from Calcutta used to come by those the rickshaws. And these rickshaws used to wait over there and carry them, and once in a week, and only on Saturday, Sunday, they used to earn, and very less earning. The women, they started coming to me, and the Swamiji, our husbands earning sufficient money, at least 200 rupee in a week is sufficient for us, but we are not getting even a single farthing from them, because one, gambling, the shop has opened, and the wine and gambling and all those things, when they come back after dropping the guest in the station, in between there's a place and they spend the whole amount over there. And I called those rickshaw wallahs, and they knew me. I used to give them a lot of gifts. So I told, why you are doing like this? Swamiji, it is impossible. The way you are passing through that, the smell of wine just make us blind. We cannot. So that is why we are doing. I told, okay, how much you earn? So 100 rupee per day. The 60 rupee at least minimum, you should keep in such a way that you cannot tie it out, open it. And 40 you can keep in your front pocket. Spend the 40 and then go give the 60 to your wife. And few days it continued. Then it became opposite. 60 spending 40. Then again the complaint started coming. It is the present day story. And this man, he is telling. And it is, who is writing? Rishi. It's not an ordinary man that writing this. It's the Rishi is writing. And even the person, the thoughtful person, an intellectual person, he was also suffering. Do not play with dice till your land and rejoice in your income and property so obtained, feeling great. I went to Kashi, Benares, before coming to Chicago, and I was visiting the mandir, and someone gave me 1,000 rupee, 10 rupees note, 1,000. So very new, I thought, what I am going to do with this money? I started distributing. After bathing in the Ganga, I came up, I was distributing, and they were telling all people will come and jump on you, pounce on you, nothing. They were very nicely, they were sitting, poor people, elderly people. And suddenly I noticed when I was going on giving, one taxi driver, he stopped the taxi, came out and looked at me that I am distributing 10 rupee. Immediately he came and sat by the side of the line, the queue, in the queue. And he was so dirty that you cannot make out that he is a taxi driver. And you know that in that part they do not put on the uniform or anything. So I was almost like a big, but I noticed him. When I reached over there, I gave the money to this person and to the next person, and then I avoided him. Then he said, Swamiji, mere liye? Then I told, you know, that is a, though he was senior than me, but the Swamis have the authority to say beta. So I told him, my son, beta, you are a taxi driver. You can earn your own money. And these people cannot earn their livelihood. They have come on the last stage, on the road. It's a very, very bad life, depending on the grace of the others. But you are a taxi driver. You should earn and live on the head high. Why should you beg? You know what reaction? Immediately he stood up and went to the taxi and then went away. And I could see from his eyes, he has got back the confidence. Here in this last sloka we find like this, do not play with the dice, till your land and rejoice your own income and property so often, feeling great about it. Consider yourself fortunate for possessing your cattle and having your wife with you. This is the message of the Lord Savitra has revealed to me. This is a Rishi. He is writing like this. May we conquer poverty by removing ignorance. May we conquer hunger by being productive. May we conquer battles by being valiant. And this is India. And this India is always teaching us to be, the Swami Vivekananda said, I want that education by which one can stand on his own feet. That education. Not the certificates only. Mere certificates are not necessary. So thank you, friend. And the last loka, let us chant together. Sangachaddam Pitrvi Swam Yami Nishta Purotena Parame Vyoman. And O spirit of the dead, we are praying for our ancestors. Go to the highest heaven and meet with Yama and your ancestors. Carry with you only the good karmas, leaving behind the bad. Seek a body of a new home. Seek a body and a new home and a life of glory. That is the prayer of the Rig Veda, and that way we are praying to our ancestors. And this is really excellent. And the third, they are talking about the creation. Now it is already 12:10, so we may not be able to continue. If you have any question, please ask. In the next, again, the next coming Sunday, this is the November over. In the December first Sunday, we will discuss about this, the spirituality, the creation, and many other things that you find in the Rig Veda. And along with the society, we'll try to cover that too. So if you have any question, please ask me. Yeah.
Swamiji, in spite of this wonderful exhortations in Rig Veda about the social life, why did it degenerate to the level which we see today?
That is because, you know, we will also discuss about the history. The Indian history, the one after another, the waves came from outside who were not having this type of culture. And the moment there is a prosperity, it is obvious people from all direction will come to you. And because of the philosophy, we broad-mindedness, we told them, you are welcome, you can come and settle. And there, slowly, slowly, for some reason, we lost our that valor, and we could not develop a courageous soldiers to protect us. The Kshatriya Veera, Kshatriya Dharma, that was lost. One after another incident happened. And that is the reason, the moment we were not protected, the first generation or the best philosophers, then naturally they went backward. And there cannot be a vacuum. So obviously, those people, they took that seat of the leadership, spiritual leadership, they were not capable to. And they are called the Brahmanic age. This Brahmanic age, it became very powerful in the Gupta age. And that is the reason in the Gupta age, other things also happened. There's a fractions, they went out, and that the Jaina, and then the Buddha, all these fractions because of the Gupta age, the Brahmanic age. And they reduced the whole thing. See how the women are protected. We will discuss about the Monu also in all our the saga of the soul. Then we will discuss about the Monu, the creator of the law, how much respect they are giving to the women. Because we know in a society, women are those persons who can actually create the whole family. And the family is a unit of the human society. So this is the reason, as you were asking, why we degenerated, because of the bad people took the leadership of the spirituality and they started putting so many other things. When in the Bhagavad Gita, very clearly the Lord is telling, Chatur Varnam Maya Srishtam Guna Karma Vibhagasha, not from the Jati, not from the Janma, but from the Guna and Karma. His capacity to work and his quality. Accordingly, I have made four varnas, four divisions. Now these people, they told, no, only those born out of a Brahmin is a Brahmana. He has all these facilities. And that is the reason in the this age, Swami Vivekananda said, whether you believe it or not, he said, not out of emotion, but very, very historical point of view. From the day Sri Ramakrishna advented, he came, and the Satya Yuga again came back. Why? The same Brahmana. Who is this Brahmana who is going and taking the alms from a very low caste lady? To become a Brahmana, on that occasion of the sacred thread ceremony, the first lady she went to ask for her Bhiksha Mata, she was a very low caste lady. She is telling, no, human is human. Only you have to see the quality. Ma Sharadamani Devi is asking all the other children of her household, go and touch the feet of a doctor. But he was a mandal. Mandal means, again, he was not Brahmin. Other ladies were telling, whispering to mother, mother, perhaps you don't know, he's not a Brahmin. How you can send your children to touch his feet? What was the mother was telling? He's a highly educated person. If you are not going and giving him respect and touching his feet and getting his blessings, whom you are going to offer pranam? So the all is Brahmana means educated, cultured, advanced people. So now that is whatever have happened. That's a very sad story of the India. Now all our people, without understanding, they go on criticizing. That's also very wrong. We have to understand that we are withstanding such a long history. And now you are constantly going on criticizing. We are now overcoming. It is only 70 years we have got the freedom. And after the freedom, all the leadership in the hands of some chaotic people. They don't have the proper knowledge about the India. And you have to go back to the Vedas. You have to learn from the Vedas. And with scientific view, you have to analyze the Veda. Then only you can really feel what is India.
I think.
Now there's this old debate has come up in a new way. In India, I was listening to the news and reading the newspaper. The old discussion is going on, whether the Aryans came from outside or not. Actually, this was again the Europeans who were ruling us. They started telling like this, because they could not completely deny the Vedas. They could not completely deny our scriptures. Because hundreds of scriptures, the literature, Vedic literature we will discuss. So many literatures, you cannot simply in one go say it is all rubbish. So they were very smart people. They told that all those things were done by our ancestors who came from Europe. You cannot claim the credit in that. Our people came, so they took that way, and they were in good in propagation. And you will see in India, even a good person, he never talk about himself. But they always talk. So that was the propagation, that Aryans came from outside, and sometimes they are good. Ramachandra is an Aryan, and he went down south to fight with the non-Aryans, Anarya, which was that Ravana. But my question is, Swami Vivekananda laughed on this. My question is, if Rama is an Aryan going to the Ravana, in which language they could converse? There is no interpreter. But they had a long discussion. In which language? Sanskrit. And when Rama was preparing for the war, the fight, He was worshipping goddess Durga for her blessings. Ravana also did the same thing. How come the same type of culture in both? And not only that, when the Hanumanji went to see that the Ravana's place, he came back with a report, Rama, this Ravana's place, Lanka, is full of gold and so prosperous, so well maintained. Even your Ajodhya is not like that, Hanumanji told. So how come this type of things they can say? So this is Swami Vivekananda's idea, very clear. This conception of Arya and Anarya is not race, but culture. A cultured person is Aryans, and the wives of the cultured person, they used to call their husband Arya. So that is the culture, it is not the race. Okay then, so let us chant once again this. Ya etam devam, ekabritam veda, sa sarvasmai vipashyati, yaccha pranani, yacchana, tamidam nigatam saha, sa esha eka, eka brid, eka eva, sarve asmin deva, eka brito bhavanti. He is one, the one alone. In him all deities become one alone. So that is what is our knowledge, our Hinduism, they say. And next class we will talk about another part of the Rig Veda. We have divided it into three, and in the three it is, first is regarding the deities, and second is secular subjects, and third is philosophical. So that philosophical aspect of Rig Veda we will read, we will discuss in our next class.